Breastfeeding in public, are young mothers comfortable doing this? Is breastfeeding the right thing to do? Are they breastfeeding long enough? And what is this baby-friendly initiative that's been launched in hospitals in Brooklyn and across the United States to encourage young mothers to breastfeed their babies? My guests are two experts who are doing quite a lot of work in this area. Brittany Wright, a certified health education specialist at a Brooklyn hospital, and CUNY College Professor Catherine Ma. Welcome to Brooklyn 45.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What is this breastfeeding initiative that I've been hearing about, this baby initiative?
So Baby Friendly was an initiative that was started by the World Health Organization and UNICEF back in 1991. And what they did was they did a lot of research and they found that there are three major components contributing to optimal maternal and child health. And those were breastfeeding, skin to skin, and rooming in. So they developed an initiative that launched globally, and they brought it to the United States, calling it the Baby Friendly Hospital Initiative, just to make sure that they had supporting mothers who were going to breastfeed and just care for their children from start to finish.
Catherine, you've been shaking your head a lot. You've been doing a lot of research in this area. What are you adding to what Brittany just said?
I totally agree with the impact of skin-to-skin contact. Mm-hmm. That changes the hormone levels of the mother to help her milk start producing. And, you know, the rooming in really does make a big difference. Unfortunately, when I gave birth, the hospital that I gave birth in was not breastfeeding friendly. So it was difficult, and I did not find the maternity staff to be very supportive, which kind of like prompted my interest into studying breastfeeding to try to change the way women experience breastfeeding to be more empowering. So that's how I got into this area. And it's a big passion for me.
You have three kids.
Yes, I have three kids, all whom were breastfed. And each kid was a very different experience. And there were a lot of difficulties that I faced, which also ignited my passion in this field. So I think what I'm trying to do overall is to try to change the way women are taught how to breastfeed, to focus more on the infant and her mother, as opposed to women relying primarily on medical staff, because there's a big biomedical influence in how women are taught how to breastfeed
today. What do you mean by that?
It starts back with the history of breastfeeding, the history of obstetrics and gynecology, where the focus was, I think, in the 18th century, where male doctors decided that they were going to help women learn how to breastfeed. And they were very strict in the model that they used. It was a very standardized type of model that put most of the power, if not all of the power, into what the male doctors would tell the mothers to do. And I felt that that was a big detriment to the field of breastfeeding. And I think that contributed to also the low rates of breastfeeding that we saw starting in the 1970s. My mother didn't breastfeed me. And it's kind of ironic that I am a breastfeeding researcher. So I think that's very interesting. And I wanted to change that. I think when I started having problems when my daughter was first born, I was kind of like at a crossroads, and I wanted to change the experience of breastfeeding just for her, if she chose to breastfeed. And it kind of like grew bigger as I started my dissertation research in looking at the lived experiences of first-time mothers. And I chose first-time mothers because I feel that they don't have any prior knowledge. So if there's any kind of significant differences, significant transformations, it would be amongst those first-time mothers. And it's a field that I love.
What are the differences that you see in the hospitals?
Just in that they are changing the culture from the staff that is providing the care to these mothers. you know, for a very long time, the way in which mothers were cared for, babies were delivered, babies were whisked away to the nursery, and that was kind of the end of it. And breastfeeding was more of, well, if you do, great, if not, not a problem. And now you've actually asked these providers, these from anesthesiology all the way to nursing on mm-hmm. both labor and delivery and mother-baby, to change the way they practice, to support moms, to make sure the baby's going right to the mom right away, barring any medical indication. Mm-hmm. And then you're keeping mom and baby together, called couplet care, the entire hospital stay. So
how
nurseries,
long is that
stay? If a mother is it delivers vaginally, it's usually 48 hours. If she is delivered by a cesarean section, it's anywhere between 72 or longer. So mom and baby are in the room together in postpartum the entire time, again, barring any medical indication. So that is very different. So nurseries, as we used to know it, are very much fading away, unless it's a NICU baby or a CC1, but they're kind of moving away from that in a huge, huge way. So you're seeing a big, big change.
Why are they moving away?
They're moving away because
I don't remember my nursery experience.
So they're moving away because the baby's in the room with the mother. So there's not a need to keep babies in the nursery mm-hmm. during the hospital stay. And what that does is that allows the mother to really focus on the baby, to watch for feeding cues. It supports breastfeeding. It goes beyond that. So you get used to your baby. You get used to bonding with your baby on a regular basis. So everything that you're going to experience when you go home, you really get to experience that when you're in a hospital, especially one that is baby friendly, because that's the standard of care.
Mm. Catherine, you're nodding your head all the time.
I think it's also important to realize that the formula manufacturers also have a big say in how hospital maternity wards are also structured, how they are built. A lot of the funding does come from formula manufacturers, and they actually structure maternity wards and NICUs in a certain configuration where it makes it hard to have that mother-child bonding. The NICU could be several floors above from the maternity ward. Mm-hmm. So that also plays a big role, which is why I think it's so important that we're having this initiative where we are actually working towards keeping mothers and babies together, because those first couple of days are very important to get the baby to be suckling, to stimulate the mother's milk production. So that is very important the first couple of days. And I think it also sets the tone for mother and infant to kind of like get to know each other. Because, you know, I think the single two most important people in the breastfeeding relationship is mother and baby, because they have to, like you said, learn about reading the infant cues. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. in my research, I found that the mothers who spent a lot of time with their babies, like, you know, the first couple of weeks, right. It's like constant mother-baby together. And the women who were able to learn how to read their infant cues, they actually had a more positive experience breastfeeding. And they also breastfed longer because they were more sensitive to these kinds of cues. And it's hard to learn it's hard to learn what these cues are.
I was going to ask you, what are these cues?
How
does a mother identify these cues?
It could be something as simple as the baby licking its lips. That's an indication that the baby wants to nurse. Because if you wait until the baby starts crying, that's a little bit too late. So you want to try to see the precursors to the feeding. And the licking of the lips is one of the infant cues that mothers can learn to look out for.
Brittany, you mentioned this earlier. So.
No, it's she's absolutely right. The feeding cues are essential. So baby licking their lips, sticking their tongue out, smacking, gnawing on their fists or thumbs, those are all cues to let the mother know that they are hungry. They do it naturally. So while breastfeeding is a skill that both mom and baby need to learn together, there are certain things that mom can look for to just know that she can put her baby to the breast and the baby will then take care of him or herself. When those feeding cues are missed, that's when you start to have some issues with breastfeeding and the duration, like Catherine was saying. The more in tune you are, the better you'll be. So it's really hand in hand. It's very fascinating to watch, for sure.
What else is there about this baby-friendly initiative that young mothers need to know about?
I would say that they really just need to know the importance of breastfeeding, and I want to say infant feeding in general, because what Baby Friendly strives to do is make sure that mothers go into pregnancy, go into labor, and leave the hospital or birthing center, wherever they decide to deliver, with all the knowledge necessary to make an informed decision on their infant feeding selection. So at the end of the day, it is mom's decision, but if they have all the tools and all the knowledge they need to make that educated decision, they're gonna be fine. So again, it's very much what they know, how they're educated on that process. So really understanding the benefits both to baby and mom going into this new experience.
Catherine, you mentioned earlier the formula feeding and the influence and impact of the big corporations. What are the dangers of formula feeding your baby too early, or at all, or too early?
I think if you use formula too early, the formula tends to keep the babies full longer. So if the babies are full longer, they're less likely to suckle at the breast. And for the first couple of weeks, the stimulation from the baby suckling is what the mother needs to establish her milk supply. So when babies are given formula early, they will suckle less at the breast. And that might impact the woman's potential to produce milk.
Huge.
Yes, Brittany.
I just echo that, because it's very, very true. And it seems very simple, but it makes a world of a difference. So when the milk is going to start coming in as soon as the placenta is delivered, which is literally at the end of delivery. And if mom is giving formula, one, the flow of the milk from formula to breast milk is different. So there is a flow preference for the baby that can incur. There's also sensitization of the baby's gut flora, which can sometimes actually irritate the baby if you're using formula and trying to use breast milk and things like that. So she hit it on the head. There are just so many benefits to breastfeeding. Breast milk can't be duplicated. You can't sell it in a store. And the first breast milk that comes out the colostrum, you cannot remanufacture that. So it's something that really and truly you make for your baby, and it's just the best source of nutrition you could provide to a newborn.
What do you say to young mothers who prefer to formula feed their babies? Do you discourage them?
No, you don't. You ask them why they feel like they need to use formula.
Yeah.
What are their reasonings behind it? What are their concerns? What have their past experiences been? What have they seen? A lot of that plays in the role. It's a behavior, right? So when you're talking about health behaviors, what are people seeing? What are people exposed to? Why do you feel that formula is a better solution?
Is it a dangerous preference?
No, I wouldn't say dangerous.
I think we also have to be cognizant of vilifying formula.
Yes.
Because that basically fuels the breast formula dichotomy, where everything is all black and white. And I think when you look at infant feeding in those terms, instead of looking at the gray areas, I think that provides a disservice to both the mother and the infant. I think it's important to figure out what the mother wants to do. Because even though breasts is best, it might not be best for that particular woman and her infant. And we have to be sensitive not to judge women for the choices that they make with regards to infant feeding. It's hard enough to be a mother. They're gonna judge you about every single thing. So I think it's also it's very important to make sure that women feel supported in whatever decision that they make.
I have to ask this question because you say it's the importance of mother understanding and bonding with the baby. What's the responsibility of the father in all this?
So a father has a huge role, father, partner, whoever. Basically, even after delivery, baby is going to mom, but let's say mom is tired. You know, she's gone through a strenuous experience and she's unable to do skin to skin. Dad can actually do skin to skin in the room, and it can actually happen after a C-section as well. So they have a huge role in supporting. You know, when a mom goes home, who's there to support her? Come on, you gotta get up. You gotta nurse the baby. So if that support role is huge, hand expression, manually removing milk from the breast, which is a skill that's taught.
Yeah.
The man does that.
They can do that, and they can be taught that. But their role is crucial, just in being able to support the mother in her journey to breastfeeding, because it is a lot of work. It's something that both mom and baby have to learn together. So huge role they have.
What are the challenges, especially here in Brooklyn, caused by absent fathers, where the mother is on her own?
I would say that a lot of the challenges you have, so you have a population of moms who might have to go back to work. They might have to go back to school. Where they don't have the time off to stay and nurse and be able to be with the baby the entire time. So when that support system is minimized, that really affects her. So, and not to mention if she has other children, that's a big thing. So you're not just caring for one other child, you have maybe another child or two other children to care for, and you want to make sure everyone eats and everyone is taken care of. And a newborn in itself is work.
Yes.
So to know that you have to, could potentially be feeding a baby 8 to 12 times in a 24-hour period, no matter through the night, and then you have other children, it can be a daunting task. So the absence of support is very real, and it can really impact a lot of different health behaviors that she decides to take part in, just breastfeeding.
Health repercussions as we see it manifested in the babies.
Yes.
You were talking earlier before the show began about these taboos, breastfeeding in public. And this initiative is encouraging ladies to breastfeed in public.
Yes.
Talk about the difficulties you've experienced or you've heard from ladies who have been breastfeeding in public or who are afraid to breastfeed in public.
So you have, so when you talk about breastfeeding in public, you have to also bring into the conversation culture. And the reason why I say that is because in the United States, breastfeeding is not the norm, if you will. It's growing to be, but for a very long time it wasn't. So when you look at other countries in the world, breastfeeding is very normal. You're going to see moms with their babies latched in any public setting. But here it's kind of, well, maybe she should cover up or so on and so forth, and maybe she shouldn't breastfeed in this public of an area. And that is changing. They are creating laws to change that. As a matter of fact, in New York, you cannot tell someone that they cannot breastfeed in public. So it's very much changing a lot. So
I also think a lot of mothers don't realize that they have federal law backing them where they can breastfeed wherever they want. But I think the problem is social acceptance. It's still not normalized in the United States. But if you go to a rated R movie, you can see breasts splayed everywhere, but it seems it seems troublesome when a mother is trying to nurse her baby mm-hmm. in public. I mean, I've nursed my children in public.
Yeah.
I've nursed on rides at Disney World. I've nursed probably in every single park at Disney World. And I was always ready for someone to say, oh, you should do that in the bathroom. Oh, that's disgusting. And I was always ready for someone to say that. Because once they said that, I was going to say, when you eat your lunch, breakfast, or dinner in the bathroom, that's when I'll feed my baby in the bathroom. But
right.
so far, I don't know, maybe it was my demeanor, maybe it was the looks I gave people, but I never got that. But I was always ready.
Yeah,
I know, because
me
you did
neither.
Your hands like this. You
yeah,
she was
already ready to fight. But my experience is the same. I breastfed whenever I felt my son was ready to eat. So that's just it. And just like you said, Catherine, would you eat your lunch in the stall?
Exactly.
No? Okay.
Part of your research talked about dodging booby traps.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
The booby traps I mean is by adhering to the breast is best ideology, where women feel that they need to breastfeed at all cost. Even though they are in pain for months, they still feel that they have to breastfeed, because if they don't breastfeed, they are construed as being a bad mother. And this is not only society's construal, it's also their own internal guilt, that they've learned that breastfeeding is best. So if you want to be a good enough mother, you have to breastfeed your baby. And what I found in my research is that the women who adhere to that breast is best ideology, they tend to see things more as a dichotomy, as black and white. And there were two themes that came up in my research where mothers saw breastfeeding as either good or bad. The good mothers breastfed, and the bad mothers were selfish and they used formula. Mm. And it was very strong. The women had very harsh feelings and vilified a lot of the women who used formula. Mm. And another theme was there was a right and a wrong way to breastfeed. And right way meant that breastfeeding followed exactly how they had learned prior. And the wrong way was if they had to do something different, if they had to like adjust positions, if they had to learn new positions for their baby in order to nurse properly. And I thought it was very interesting that it was so clear cut that a lot of women adhered very, very strongly to the breast is best ideology. But there was a small portion of women who kind of like resisted this breast is best. And these were the ones that were more flexible in how they thought about breastfeeding. Mm. That if they couldn't breastfeed, they could pump the milk out and have someone else feed their babies. And that gave them more flexibility in working outside of the home, in going outside and, you know, just doing some self-care for themselves. So I chose to focus on that small group of women who were more flexible, because I felt that they were empowering themselves, that they were choosing to breastfeed on their own terms. So I recently published, it's still in the works. The abstract was accepted, but I'm still revising it. And it's focusing on exploring maternal transformation through breastfeeding. So I focus on that small pocket of women who were more flexible in how they viewed breastfeeding. It wasn't so black and white. These were the women that were like in the gray areas. And what I found was that they focused more on their infant, mm-hmm. reading their infant cues. And they started to realize that their infant is a very active participant in breastfeeding. Because if you think about it, most of the breastfeeding classes, they happen before the baby's born. Mm-hmm. So it's hard practicing on a doll, reading right. textbooks about it. And I always wondered, how come these classes are not offered in the early postpartum period, where the baby's there? So you could practice on your own baby. You'll have like lactation consultants. You'll have other medical professionals to help you. And I always thought that was a better idea. So I'm trying to change the way, you know, the structure is
right.
so that women feel that it's all about them and that they can make choices on how to breastfeed in a manner that fits their goals.
I'm getting my wrap-up cue.
Oh.
So Brittany, you're going to have the last word. I was going to ask you, what do you like most about the Baby Friendly Initiative? But in view of our discussion, what is your What is your advice to these young mothers?
My advice to young mothers as it pertains to breastfeeding mm-hmm. is to just educate yourself and be open to different types of education as it relates to breastfeeding, mainly because at the end of the day, this is their decision. This is a decision they are going to make on behalf of their child and their family. So the more you know, the better decision you can make. So I would just strongly encourage young women in this community, all over Brooklyn, United States, to really just feel and educate yourselves and feel empowered to ask questions.
Brittany Wright, a certified health education specialist. I'm not going to call the name of your hospital, but I'm at one of the hospitals here in Brooklyn.
Yes.
And Professor Kathleen Ma, and you're doing a lot of research. You're a mom yourself.
Yes.
And thank you for being on Brooklyn 45. Thank you for sharing the information that you have shared.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
This is Brooklyn 45. Please visit our Facebook page, like us, and post your comments about this program. Your comments and suggestions are important to us. Please also spread the word about Brooklyn 45. On behalf of our Brooklyn 45 team, I am Sam Tate.